proof? No.
This was what we have for the break. This is a transfer function of a finite impulse response field order n. You see here a truncated geometric sequence, these coefficients. They can be, because they are all zeros, they can, this alpha can be larger, also larger than 1, doesn't matter, than the geometric sequence. Increases a bit, but it is truncated anyway. Here is a formula, which is quite generic for finite impulse response. This infinity is now finite. You are always finite. It's finite impulse response. If all these alphas, this alpha is 1, then I have this simple sum and I have a standard rectangular pulse. Yeah, it's the most simple form. This is called a moving average filter. All coefficients are, you know, the term moving average, I was there to, I explained to you that it is refers to the this way of writing the transfer function. This is the moving average part, and this is the auto-regressive part, the AR part. And finite impulse response and infinite impulse response refer to the impulse response. Dus as one pass, one stop, and low pass, high pass refers to the frequency response. You just separate the glossary. And American books, or American books sometimes make a big mess out of it. The sampled rectangular, and I want to show you how to arrive at the periodic sync function. And when only a few people were here this morning, I showed you how to what is the mathematics behind this? This is the Chebyshev polynomial.
Processes like spreading a film over a surface. You can measure, let's say, for example, surface pressure. Uh-huh. Yes, then you build the function of surface pressure from a specific compound, which is used by the pharmaceutical industry, and then you can filter this sample through this problem. Now I realize how it works actually. It's not a, not the sound signal, but it's a signal which is can be digitally filtered, maybe using the same functions.
I'm happy that you recognize it, but and also good remark, what I do here as in fact it's nothing to do with electronics. This is or applied mathematics.
Yes, yes.
See,
so because we use moving average filter, that's why I...
The practical application is the charge coupled device in the old cameras before they became really digital, because now the memory is CMOS. You also have analog memory, charge coupled device, so you store charges, capacitors, so they're volatile. These are the physical realizations, and what you said in the book, these are already close to the physical realizations.
Yes.
That's where finally, touch your final goal. But what I'm presenting here is only the first step in your design, the architectural level one here, and all the stuff with you have to do with silings, still has to come afterwards. I've boxed hermetic here and they say, oh, I'm ready. This, no, you're not ready. This is the beginning of your design. There's a long way to go. You have to, how do you realize? I show you different structures, different box hermetics for the same transfer function. Here it already starts. This is an architectural decision. You have to make a trade-off between which block diagram you choose. And at abstract level, it's crucial which decision, what you choose. You do not know how it works out, but it is crucial. And when you are near the level you are, then you look back and say, oh, I've chosen the wrong architecture. But then it's too late. You have to do your work all over again. So I only show you the two upper levels of abstraction. The first one, collecting specifications, splitting in design and test environment, and then focusing on architecture. Architecture is an algorithm. This is the algorithm part of it, and the architecture part is this block diagram. They are linked. That's a good illustration. Now, we solved, I think, well, we have solved this already yesterday. Again, quickly, I want to have pole zero analysis. Zeros here, poles here. You have n zeros, that's the solution of this algebraic equation. You have one pole, that's this one, it's n fold. Oh, sorry, that's zero. And one pole here at the unit circle. Ah, but here you are lucky because the n zeros also has a zero at z is one. So what you have is n minus one zeros because at z is one, there's nothing, there's only a finite value. And this is the maximum of this periodic sink that you will arrive at. This is the pole zero diagram, as you see now. This is now the unit circle, because and I have coefficients alpha is one. And on this point, we have a finite value, which is, in fact, is equals to n. And if I look at the frequency characteristic, you really now have zeros. And this is the one that will be the fundament of filter synthesis. This one. Okay, mathematics. The transfer function. Now we going to form the transfer function mathematically. We now going to compute the frequency response. Graphically, it goes. You can see you take a pair of scissors here, and you take this out and you put it. And you have one period described along the frequency axis. But mathematically, you fill this in, and you arrive at this one. Now, and what shall you do next to solve this? Now, big trick. I take half of this term outside, and I do the same here. And what I then arrive at is, somewhat more of the, I take half of this outside and left with this, the numerator with this, the denominator with this. And now I apply Euler's identity again, and I combine these two. This is only not affecting the amplitude, only affecting the phase shift. And I end up for the final phase shift with this factor and this one becomes a sign. That becomes effective because this one divided by this one, two sinc functions, a quotient, but this one and this one, I can throw out. The, okay, they can multiply them. And I left over this expression, and this n also drops out. Now, this, I put it here for on purpose. If you have the limit for f is zero, then you have zero divided by zero, but you know that the sinc function of f is zero is one. And so this is one divided by one. If you do this here, it's less clear. If you fill in zero here, zero here. So that's why I rewrote it. I can easily see what the limit case is. And for f is zero, I end up with amplitude one. Let's see how the picture. I don't know why this is still here. Is this a clear picture? Yeah, it's clear than on my screen. What you have here, this is amplitude n. And you have here this pattern, the sync pattern, but you also have one period later this sync pattern in here, and they align. Yeah, because they are infinitely wide. So I have here a pattern of a periodic sync function. This is called a periodogram, which is used as a basis for the spectral estimation as well. Okay, yes, the same as what I say in words. This is the phase factor, this determines the amplitude. So this, the single sinc functions are periodic, but this is periodic function. Periodic divided by periodic is periodic. Okay. See it here. This is an important picture to keep in mind. So you have a sinc function, then one at the next at the sampling frequency you have another one, and two times the sampling frequency you have it here, and here's the Nyquist rate, and the overlap starts. So this is not if you take this part, this is not a sinc function, but it is part of a periodic sinc function. The thing to remember is you have in one period you have one maximum, and you have here tuk, all these zeros, and do not take this maximum twice because this then already belongs to another period. So you have exactly n points, one maximum and n minus one zeros. And keep in mind if in order n, sphere filter, where the alpha is 1, where you have a rectangular sampled rectangular.
So here we want to keep only the global maximums.
Yep.
We want to get rid of the zeros, right? Or not?
No, the global maximum is here and the zeros, they.
Yes, a blind filter, how can it help to clarify the sign?
This filter function.
Yes.
Ah, that is the explaining filter. This filter synthesis part. This will come. Okay, we have time for this. And I also want to make time for this. And then, because what you then do, this is now the comb filter is your fundament. So now you have your fear filter, which is comb filter multiplied by something else that creates this. This is in fact a low pass filter. You put here at 0 hertz, but you can also put a sinc function here at this point, this point, this point. And then you have a wider band, and you have a fast band. These global maxima here, they're part of the stop band. So if you want to have a stop band with lower level, you have to create a longer delay line. It lowers down. And the pass band you can create by putting on the, upon the zeros these factors that create this maximum. You can also leave this out here and create a bandpass filter by putting only these main lobes here. The bandpass filter. This is already in a nutshell how you synthesize the filter towards your characteristic. But so that's the importance of this. In practice, you will not use this as a filter, low pass filter. This itself is a very bad filter. The only advantage is, and we will show that, this is a bad amplitude characteristic. This is not flat. And this is a very bad stop band. But it has in the phase characteristic, it has a very good property. It has exact linear phase. Because it is the impulse response is a rectangle, which is an even function. So it is a linear phase. But now I'm running ahead of what is going to come. But, this is a question for the students. And the solution, I did not give them themselves. I think it's the same story again. Again, this finite impulse response filter, you get all these zeros. But now, this is not one, this is alpha. So we have a circle within the unit circle, but it can also could also be a circle outside the unit circle. Because for zero stability, doesn't matter. And here you always get this and minus one point pole. And I explained you can put as many poles as you want there, it's at zero. Because a pole here means nothing that you delay your impulse response. Times z minus one is delaying your time signal. And in the Laplace transform, z is zero, corresponds with minus infinity in the p-plane. Minus infinity means, you're far from stability problems. That is, so here again, the same picture, but now for a circle with radius alpha. Doing the same computations again. I can substitute, I take this one mathematically. I compute the frequency characteristic by substituting e to the power of, instead of z minus 1, e to the power of this, and again an equation in f, and you get this equation, and now it is not so easy to solve anymore. Here is some results. Local minima, you have no zeros anymore, you have now minima, you have local maxima, these are these small bubbles, these side lobes, and a global maximum for the main lobe. And for F0, you can compute it. F0 is this one. Then F0, this becomes your global maximum, this is dependent on alpha. And of course you have problems in alphas approaching 1, but this one is also approaching 1, and if you look at this, because there is this pressure for normal 1, then it is, you have here n, a big n again, so no problems. So you have the same picture, similar picture, not the same, I used the same picture because I was lazy. I did not want to draw it again. I just listed it a bit to make them not zeros, but just minima. They're all at the same level, but so you have this n minus 1 dips and one maximum. 1 plus n minus 1 is an n order filter. This is what the result is. When, yeah, I did it. This is from MATLAB, of course, picture. For n is 16. You can count the zeros. You have 1 here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And the other side. 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 15. Wait a minute.
No, it's okay because 1, 2,
6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7,
8.
8, yeah, 15. Because here this belongs to the other period already. 15 plus 1, 16. Yes. Okay, yeah. Yeah, it fits. Did I make a mistake? No, it's correct. And yeah, okay, if you then write the amplitude and phase characteristic of this, you take, if you really split it up, the amplitude looks like this. So it's not a real, it's a bit blurred here. They're not really zeros anymore, except for here. And the phase also non-linear. That you see here, because you can see it from here. Yep, you can see it from here. I was looking for it. This is the impulse response, and it's all fast. This is a geometric sequence. This is not an even or odd function. So the phase is not linear. So it perfectly fits the theory. But this is how it looks like for alpha smaller than one. Alpha is larger than one. It pumps up. But it doesn't explode because you truncate it here. So always stable. And this is not even a necessary condition. The schematic, now we have seen that, I think, 100 times. Oh. Yeah. Huh? This performs convolution, it's a moving average structure. It is a finite impulse response. These are the coefficients. Mm-hmm. There's a little more to say about this. The only thing to say about this, and to continue the writing things.
Yes, always.
It's a model. Now, you can also write this. I have a second block schematic, which also forms. We've demonstrated that yesterday here for an example of four delay elements, fourth order fear filter. Now, that's what you have here. Here you have your comp filter, your other elementary filter, and here you have this infinite impulse response filter order 1, which we will revisit shortly. This is a moving evidence structure, special type, only 2 taps, and this one has one loop, one feedback path, and the pole created here outweighs the zero created here. And the remark I made yesterday, I can make again, this is mathematically is no problem, but when you realize it, it's good to keep it in this sequence. You allow mathematically to do this first, and then this, and edit the results. But then the risk exists because your computers have truncations, of number truncations, that the zero here and the zero there are not exactly matching numerically. And then the pole will start to overrule the zero here. Not, the pole cannot compensate the zero here, it's not exactly on the same place. And then the pole takes overhand and your system blows up in practice. So mathematically is no problem, but when you work this out, you might be in trouble. Eh? Yeah, first this, then this, and not first this and then this. Linear phase. Ja, dat is de second case. Oké. Ja, we can do that before lunch. Ja, in the afternoon we do then the infinite impulse response filters. Linear phase. I already told you the conclusion. I also shall give you the proof, the mathematical proof. Because you really can prove it. How do you be certain that your finite impulse response filter, which restrictions do you have to put on your discrete impulse response? Now, the answer is, you put restrictions on the symmetry, and I already told you, you have to, this impulse response has to be either an even function or an odd function. It can be both. If it is not, then you do not have linear phase. To prove this, we are going to revisit the Fourier symmetry properties. we prove it, yeah, okay, we do it the other way around. We have an even function, or we have the h of t, we can split it in an even and an odd part. The even part becomes here, becomes the real, and the odd part becomes imaginary. Now, to this is then so the h of minus f. This is h of minus f turns out to be this. You have to remember this picture for the about symmetry. And what you have then is h conjugate of f. And yeah, this is not very revolutionary because I have a real function, and this means simply that the real part is even and the imaginary part is odd. Just, but now if you now look at the exploring this sequence again, wait a minute. Yep, this is what. And here the impulse, if the impulse response is even, because I can also do it the other way around, it works both ways, then this holds, this property holds, the minus n. But because it is finite, I can also, instead of zero, put an n here. And for the odd functions, you have the standard except for the minus sign here. And if you do the Fourier transform of this one, and yeah, you get this one for the even functions. And now, this is the phase that you have
observeert is in ieder geval G5F. Dit is G5F. Dit is de minus sign then. En this one, dat is de this factor here. So you take here the face, comes the face here. And bringing this to the other side, you end up with this relationship. The conclusion is that the face characteristic is linear, it's proportional to f. But here,
the face characteristic is proportional to the frequency, right?
Yeah, yeah, proportional to the frequency. So it is linear going down. Mean minus sign, yeah, linear. And the angle is pi times at the S speed. Here, push. Slipped. The proof is correct. It's not that important. So, odd or even means even face characteristic, yeah, and so forth. If it is even face characteristic, then your impulse response is even or odd. Works both ways. And you can put that in a table, which is only for reference. It doesn't have a practical effect. There is a picture on the next slide, but you can put an even impulse response, even an impulse response odd. The other thing you can do is you have an even order, the length of the delay line is even, or the length line of the of the delay line is odd, and for the relationship because it's n, right? If you position the impulse response symmetrical around zero. Later on, you can, in reality, you can shift it back to positive n. You have this relationship, and the other, which is also symmetrically located around n is zero. This is the same, of course, you can see. Then you see there is a slight. No, it's the same equation except for the minus, for the n, for the even and the odd. you end up if you going to compare all the values of the coefficients of the impulse response, that here already at half you have yeah, but you don't have to go further, and here there is one more. I go to the pictures because this makes it much more clear. Where is the picture? This picture. You have the even impulse response, you have the odd impulse response. Now, if the you have an odd order, then there is a line here. You have exactly a line in the center where it is maximum. And if it is, you have always a point in the middle. If n is even, you have 2 points, giving a maximum or the same value, an opposite value. This is the even case and this is the odd case. The point in the middle, this should be zero, but when n is even, it is not there. So, but the symmetry is there. Here, you really have a point where h of n is really zero.
yes, sometimes it helps you to verify even of odds. In the middle, something if this collective is odd, that you have only one. For the even function, maximum or some unique value. And here you always have zero for the odd version of the impulse response. I now have to solve if I now this is the even or the odd impulse response. I translate it to polynomial, but the polynomial has now even or odd coefficients. It's now not that easy to solve as in the previous case with when they are all equal, because then the poles were equally distributed around the unit circle. If these like here, have coefficients all one, then we have them equally distributed on the unit circle. If you have these coefficients arbitrary but okay, even, then they are on the they are within the poles are within the unit circle, but not at the same angle and not necessarily on the unit circle. They can be shifting around, and that's the degree of freedom we have for linear phase filters. As long as they lie within the unit circle, you can shift them around according to the coefficients. There is one restriction. If you look at the at the zeros, sorry, this is of course a free filter, they occur in pairs, and I put them on on the same circle. It doesn't have to be this. And this can also be at another circle, but they occur in pairs like this. And this has to do with the even and the odd, the oddness of the impulse response. They even this pair, this pair, but you also have, you could also have here this pair. So you have a pair, a quartet, four poles constellated. Belonging together. That's how then the poles, the zeros occur for a linear phase filter. That's always a good check. Do you have the correct pole zero diagram? Just check for the quadruples. This picture we had, there's some other pictures, similar information that I'm trying to do. This is again the same information. There's a lot of redundant information in the slide. That's why there are so many slides. Okay, again this picture, this is for NS8. You have one main lobe. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And then the next period starts, 7 zeros. This one main lobe. And for NS9, you see the evenness and the oddness of the. So this is for an even impulse response. This is for an odd impulse response. You have your maximum 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
you look at the Nyquist frequency, then if it is odd, then here the Nyquist frequency always has zero. And here you always have a local maximum. It's a slight difference. Yeah, you can see it directly from the this repeated sink that you have. This is from a book, so it confirms that, okay, what I just said, the poles, the zeros are occurring in quadruples. And now, since the zeros are here, you walk around the unit circle, and here you receive some local maximum here. Walk, and here you experience a minimum because here you have to pass the two zeros, then it rises again. So this angle coincides with this frequency. Yeah. Yeah. So mapping. And then see if you're here, and then you have a new minimum again. And here, I think the writer makes a mistake. Because these maximums should be equal, because these angles are equal. So I do not see why this maxima should be unequal. I think he did the wet finger method and drew it.
Because the middle maximum is not between zeros.
This one?
Yes, it's represented the real axis. Yeah, right.
Real axis here, no, here you have a zero.
Ah, yes.
Yeah, this is a minimum here.
Yes, minimum. And the maximum is on the opposite side.
It's repeat, so this is yes. A one period spectrum. And here there is a maximum because you're far away from the zeros. And here we are approaching them. And here, so if these angles are equal, then this maxima should also be this equal distance, also be equal amplitude. Well, doesn't matter, it's just illustration. The important is, you see here, the phase is linear. And you, in practice, you observe jumps because you limit within 360 degrees. So you get a sawtooth like phase characteristic, but of course modulo 2 pi. You subtract multiples of 2 pi and you stay within this reach. This is a linear phase.
That's amplitude, that's phase. So that corresponds to this one, and the distance between this local minimum and this local minimum is same, but the number, the what was that again, the circle of units, passed the imaginary axis not at the same angle between the two,
It looks that if the angles are equal, but I should say that these angles are equal, but this is smaller.
Yes, this part smaller. Than this part.
Yeah, not 60 degrees, so this one is smaller than 60 degrees.
And that's where you have those two.
Yeah, then they become bigger, yeah. It's not clear to be seen from the picture. No. This circuit, now I'm getting tired of this. Linear phase. This quarter to one, I think we make a stop here. And in the afternoon, we have two cases for the infinite impulse response filter. The first one, we have already seen most of it. Quickly, I want to focus on this one. This is an interesting one because you have three options depending on the solutions of your poles. And also you can see to solve them how the poles are moving in the complex plane. That's for the afternoon. I did not invent this myself, of course. This is from the Schaum's outlines. I took this is really a very practical book. Americans, they are very practical. In theory, they are very sloppy, but these books are very useful and they do not cost much.